Moby, your doc comes out on Friday. What was it about it now, telling your story about music and who you are and your activism?
Well, part of it is a result of getting sober. And what I mean by that is, I finally, after a lifetime of lunatic addiction, got sober about 12 years ago. And once I got sober, I started spending a lot of time at 12-step meetings. And one of my favorite things was hearing people's stories. You know, hearing people tell their stories honestly and in entertaining ways. And I just realized, like, I'd gotten to a point in my life where I've had a lot of very odd experiences, and I presumptuously think I've learned something. So the idea of like writing a memoir or releasing this documentary is just simply to share my experience and perspective in the hope that somehow it might connect with someone who can benefit from it, which I know sounds presumptuous, but that was the goal.
Yeah. And the one thing I like about this documentary is that it really does touch on a lot of different subjects in your life and things that I didn't even know about you. And I'm a big fan of your music. I've been a big fan since high school. And what was it about opening up? Was there some like things that you didn't really want to talk about on this documentary and things that were like, or was everything on the table?
Yeah, I mean, basically everything was on the table, and largely because as time has passed, I've really come to appreciate when people are willing to be honest. You know, I mean, sometimes the lack of honesty can be very entertaining, but for the most part, you know, when someone is actually willing to be human and honest and talk about the things they're ashamed of, to talk about their shortcomings, to their battles with anxiety or depression or addiction. I mean, we live in this world, and forgive me for stating the obvious, but we live in a world where people try to present themselves as something they're not, you know, whether it's on Instagram, whether it's politicians being completely disingenuous. So I just thought, at the very least, let me try to be honest.
Yeah. And that's something like me and my buddy Fredo Ortiz have talked about many times, is that as we get older, we want that honesty more. And I agree with you on that.
Well, also, I mean, like, I've gotten to that point in my life where I'm 55 years old. Like, I'm bald, my beard is gray. You know, like my youth is largely behind me, and I could either go the LA route and get like tons of plastic surgery and do my best to sort of like try and like give the illusion of being young, or just accept that we get old, you know, like it's part of the human condition.
Yeah, I agree with you because like I'm 46 and I'm starting to see gray come out and I'm like, okay, what's
Yeah.
next? Gotta move forward. But the one thing I did want to talk to you about is that one point in the documentary that I really loved because I'm a big David Bowie fan. And to talk about your relationship with David Bowie was really cool. And how was that? How was it like to have somebody like that be almost like one your neighbor become friends with and then collaborate musically with?
Yeah, I mean, David Bowie was my favorite musician of all time. The first job I ever had when I was 12 or 13 years old was working as a caddy at a golf course. And I only worked at this golf course long enough to save money to buy David Bowie records. You know, so I just have been so inspired by him, and I loved him and his music for such a long time. And then in 1999, we became neighbors. We became friends. We went on tour together. We had holidays together. And it was so wonderful, but also really disconcerting being friends with the greatest musician of all time and my ultimate hero. And so that's why I had to include it in the documentary, just because I still marvel at the fact that I got to be close to my favorite musician of all time.
Yeah, that had to have been really cool because I remember my very first concert was a David Bowie concert. And opening up was Lenny Kravitz. And I still remember that concert to this day and how great that concert was. One thing, talking about music, I wanted to get into the new album, Reprise, comes out Friday as well. What was it like to step back into a lot of these songs and do them acoustically, bring in an orchestra to it, and really do something different with your music?
Well, I mean, on one hand, there's a familiarity to it because I actually grew up studying music theory and playing classical music before I discovered punk rock and electronic music. And, but one of the things that's really fascinating is almost using music as a time capsule, you know, which I think we all do that with the music that we listen to, you know, remembering where we were when we, you know, like someone mentioned a song that had been a huge hit on AM radio in the mid 70s. And I remember so clearly being with my mom in the car outside the supermarket while like Bee Gees was on the AM radio. But what's, as someone who makes music, what's very interesting for me is revisiting the context in which the music was made. You know, not just what I was going through personally, but like what the world was going through. Like I remember my first real single was called Go, and there's an orchestral version on the album, and it was written at a time in around 1990 when I was living in an abandoned factory. I had no running water, I had no bathroom, but I had free electricity, and you know, I had hair. I was making around $2,000 a year. I was, you know, just like broke working on electronic music, and I never expected anyone would hear it, and I certainly never expected to have a career. So it's fascinating to remember just, you know, what my life was like and what the world was like when these pieces of music were first written.
Yeah, and that's the one thing I love is that in this album you have a lot of great talent helping you in a few of the songs. One of them is Skylar Grey, and she's on your was it The Last Day? You feature her on that song in this album, and it sounds so good. What was it about bringing in these musicians to help you out with this album?
Well, when I was really little, I wanted to be a singer. You know, I wanted to have this great voice, and I wanted to stand on stage and have one of those voices that would just captivate and move everyone. And then when I was around 16 or 17, I realized my voice isn't technically bad, but it's not great. And so a long time ago, I realized if I want to have wonderful vocals on my records, I have to work with other singers.
Yeah.
And so that's why, you know, on this album, there's everybody, as you mentioned, Skylar Grey to Kris Kristofferson and Gregory Porter and Mark Lanegan. And, you know, there's so many different vocalists, you know, black, white, young, old, male, female. Like it's such an eclectic, phenomenal array of singers.
Yeah. And it's so good. The album is so good, hearing these songs in a different way. The one thing I did want to ask you was about the orchestral arrangements. Was it tough putting your songs into orchestral and have to change them much, or did it fit in perfectly?
Well, luckily I have enough of a background in music theory that I could do the basic arrangements myself.
Oh, cool.
And also I like simple arrangements. You know, I didn't want to overcomplicate this album just because I was working with an orchestra. You know, like I still wanted there to be sort of like a simplicity and a beauty to it. I didn't want it to sound like a Disney soundtrack. Nothing against the wonderful world of Disney, but like the way they approach orchestration is so grandiose. And I wanted this to just be powerful, but beautiful. And so I did the basic arrangements and then gave them to a friend of mine who's an orchestrator. And he actually figured out how to get the orchestra to play my basic arrangements.
Awesome. And one last question, because we're already winding down with my time. But what can you tell the movie news audience to see your documentary and really, because it's a really good documentary and I love it. What can you tell them to get them to watch?
Well, on one hand, as we were talking about, like, I think that it's honest, but also I presumptuously think it's just really entertaining. Like we tried to make a documentary that's completely unlike any documentary we'd ever seen, you know, which is why there's interviews with David Lynch in it. And we tried to tell stories in a way that we'd just never seen before. So sometimes that's cartoons, sometimes it's conversations with dogs, sometimes it's fake therapy sessions. So that would be my presumptuous recommendation to people is like, it's an honest movie that I think and hope is actually really entertaining.
Yeah. And that is what it definitely is. I love music documentaries, and this one is right up there with some of my favorites in the documentary subject. Thank you so much, Moby. I look forward to seeing you on the road, seeing you on tour again, because I want to see you play in person it's been too long to see a concert, and I want to see you play in person. So thank you so much for being a part of Muse TV.
Oh, my pleasure. It was really nice speaking with you. Thank you.
Thanks.
Bye.